So people have been talking about Black history and examples of Black excellence. We need to talk about Paul Robeson.
If you don't know who Paul never mind, let's just get into it. To give you an idea of the times, Paul's dad was freed from slavery. And Paul went to Rutgers University on a scholarship because he was brilliant. And while he was there, he played football and was named All-American.
Twice.
After he graduated, valedictorian, he went to Columbia University to study law. While he's in law school, he starts training as a singer and an actor and plays football for the NFL. Then he graduates and becomes a lawyer.
But then he quit because racism.
So he just becomes a movie star.
But then he quit because racism.
The dude's mad political, so he's speaking out against the US government loud. And they don't like that, so the FBI cancels all his concerts and gets him blacklisted. So my dude takes his conscience overseas and keeps talking that mess. Then they took his passport so he couldn't travel. He starts holding telephone concerts, and thousands of people show up. And there's a lot.
So today's Leontyne Price's birthday. And some of you don't know who Leontyne Price is!
Leontyne Price is literally one of the greatest operatic sopranos to ever walk. Okay, here's the story. She was born in 1927 Mississippi, and she started playing piano at 5, and her mom sang in the church choir, but she knew she wanted to be a singer for real after seeing Marian Anderson perform at the Lincoln Memorial. You don't know who Marian Anderson is. Later. She also got a full ride scholarship to go to Juilliard, which they weren't just handing out to Black kids in the 40s, but she sounds like this. After school, she toured all through Europe, but when she had her debut at the Metropolitan Opera in New York, she finishes singing, this is her first performance, by the way, and the audience leaps to their feet and starts clapping, and doesn't stop, for 42 minutes. And that doesn't happen, except for her last performance when they did it again for 35 minutes, Leontyne Price.
We're still talking about Black excellence, and I can't talk about Leontyne Price without talking about Marian Anderson. Without Marian Anderson,
she was born in Philly in 1902 and she grew up singing in the church choir. And she was really good, so when she got a little older and wanted some more training, she went to the Philadelphia Academy of Music and they told her, we don't take Negroes and we never will.
Bet you do now though.
Anyway, so her church got together and raised the money for her training and she was able to put on some concerts, but racism. So she goes to Europe to start a career because apparently Europe was less racist than the US in the 20s. Oh dang, I gotta start saying 1920s, huh? Anyway, she actually went by ship, but this picture was fire, so. She was known to perform classical European pieces alongside Negro spirituals, and Europe just fell in love with that voice. So now that she's world famous, when she gets back to the US, everyone starts acting brand new. Except,
I'm out of time. I'll tell you in part two.
Hold up. All right, I just needed that for the thumbnail thing. Marian Anderson 2, let's go. So Marian Anderson tours Europe, becomes this world famous international opera singer. So a lot of these venues in the United States are suddenly feeling a lot more comfortable about her performing there. So she comes home like Mike Jones. Turns out I can't play that song. They took the other video down. So I'll paraphrase. Previously, there was no interest, but with my new acclaim, I'm in high demand. She eventually becomes the first Black woman to sing a named role at the Metropolitan Opera, but when Howard University invited her to come sing, as they do, the only place big enough to hold a Marian Anderson concert was Constitution Hall. But Constitution Hall was owned by the Daughters of the American Revolution, who said only white artists can perform in their building. So, First Lady Eleanor Roosevelt, who happens to be a member of the DAR, quits the DAR and helps Marian put on a concert at the Lincoln Memorial. And 75,000 people came to listen. This is singer-songwriter Madison McFerrin, who also happens to be the daughter of Bobby McFerrin, the musical genius and the guy who wrote Don't Worry, Be Happy, who also happens to be the son of the great baritone Robert McFerrin. Now, if you don't know who this is, you need to, and you're about to. Born in Arkansas in 1921, he was actually a boy soprano in his church gospel choir. Gospel was the only music he was allowed to sing as a kid. His dad was a Baptist preacher. He attended Fisk University, got drafted into World War II, and when he finished college, he moved to New York to study voice with the composer Hall Johnson. And dude was good, because a year later he was singing in a bunch of musicals and operas. And in 1955, he became the first Black man to sing a role at the Metropolitan Opera. And when he was done with that, he moved to Hollywood to be in the movies. So if you've ever seen that 1959 Porgy and Bess movie with Sidney Poitier, his singing voice. The Grammy for the Best Roots Album went to the Fisk Jubilee Singers. Do you know who they are? Because this is historic. Right after slavery was abolished, a lot of the newly freed wanted to learn to read and write. So schools were started, and a lot of those schools became our HBCUs. And in Nashville, Tennessee, one of them was Fisk University. At a certain point, the school got into real financial trouble, like there wasn't going to be any more school financial trouble. So the music teacher, who also happened to be the treasurer, took some of the choir students to neighboring towns to sing for donations. But they're not really singing standard European choral works. They're singing their music, the stuff that was composed and passed down by the enslaved, namely Negro spirituals. And they blew up. Remember, this is America's first time hearing African-American music. So they had to go on tour, they sang for the president, they sang for the queen. There were other groups coming out of Nashville pretending to be them. Man, they came back to Nashville with money. They paid off debts, bought new land, built a new school. And the group members have changed through the years, but they kept the music alive. Last thing, Nashville's Music City reputation, they started it. Turns out June is Black Music Appreciation Month, so let's learn about some Black opera history. The first Black person to sing at the Metropolitan Opera was not Robert McFerrin nor Marian Anderson. It was Helen Phillips. And the reason even opera singers haven't heard of her, besides the racism, is because she sang in the opera chorus. And look, opera doesn't care about the chorus. I mean, they do. She was born in St. Louis and her father was a Baptist minister. She studied music at Fisk University. And in 1947, the Metropolitan Opera called her agent asking for his best soprano. And guess who shows up? So they send her right in and she sings in the chorus for 3 performances of Cavalleria Rusticana. All right, so let's recap and bring this full circle. Helen Phillips, first Black person to sing at the Met. 11 years later, Robert McFerrin is the first Black man to sing at the Met. But 20 days before that, Marian Anderson was the first Black person and woman to sing a role at the Met. She also had a concert in Mississippi where a 9-year-old girl in the audience decided she wanted to grow up to be her. Her name was Leontyne Price. And part of Ms. Price's training was paid for by a benefit concert held by Paul Robeson.